Now calling patient 1882.
Whether you're tuning in for match analysis, tactical previews, or injury reports, the doctor's got you covered. If you're in need of therapy and feeling Spurs sick, we've got your fix. Releasing early each week, so you never have to wait for an appointment.
It's glory, glory, Tottenham Hotspur!
Dr. Tottenham, we'll see you now.
Episode 30, we are the Dr. Tottenham podcast. That's Dr. Tottenham. You can find us on Twitter at Dr. Tottenham. I'm at ZTronch. We're fully staffed with an esteemed guest, who I'll introduce shortly. Tim is at TIMMAH61. Vass is at VCon1. Dan is at Yidvids. You can find us on Instagram. We're at Dr. Tottenham there. We're on Facebook as well. You can watch the pod on YouTube. We have a YouTube channel. We appreciate your subscriptions. We very much appreciate your reviews and your questions that make up so much of our pod. You can find us on iTunes, Spotify, Amazon, just about anywhere you can find us a podcast. Now let me get to our esteemed guest. We have Elena Nicola. You can find her at LilyWhite_TV. She is the creator and the host of the YouTube channel LilyWhite_TV, and she also spends about an hour on Spurs on the Football Terrace, which you can also find on YouTube. Elena, welcome to the Dr. Tottenham.
Thanks for having me. I'm really excited for this one. It's one of my
favorite. How are you?
I'm good after that win. That win was brilliant.
It was. When was the last time that we had three on the trot? Can anybody answer that? I don't know.
I genuinely don't.
It's when we were top of the league, I think.
Well, when we won a Chelsea City Arsenal wins, right?
Is that really what it was?
We didn't beat Chelsea.
Yeah. We didn't. Oh, well, it felt like a win. I'm sure there was a European match in the middle of there somewhere.
We're glad to have you on such a great victory. Three on the trot. We talked about how, you know, margins are just so fine.
Hang on a minute, mate. Sorry, Elena was about to say that we're one of her favorite podcasts.
Oh, sorry.
Cut her off.
I'm a shitload.
Let her big us up a little bit.
Elena, big us up a little bit.
One thing I like is that it's released like later on in the night, later on a Sunday. So Monday, it's the first one I listen to. This and Last Word, my two go-to Monday pods.
Okay, good to hear. It's a company. Thank you.
Yeah, and your dad listens to us as well, so we're going to shout him out. All right, so let me ask you, before we sort of get into our normal rundown, tell us about why you're Spurs. What drew you to be a fan of Tottenham?
My dad gave me zero choice in the matter. So I've got an old sister, but she was never into football. And he says, this is my dad's story of when he took me to a game. He took me to a game and he was like, your eyes glimmered. And I knew there was a bit of hope. So that's it. I roped you in from early. And that was it. I'm in a life of misery since then.
Amazing. Now, where do you live? You live in London?
Yeah, I walk to the game, so I walk to home.
All right, so you're part of the Cypriot Spurs massive then, right? You and Vass and
yeah.
So, seriously, I mean, there's clearly a contingency of Cypriot Spurs fans, isn't there?
Yeah, there definitely is. It's between us and, you know, the scummy Woolwich down the road, so. Yeah, the Cypriots between us.
Well, there's a massive Cyprus Spurs flag hanging at the stadium all the time. So
when it comes up, my dad says, "There's Cyprus flag." I mean, now, and I'm like, I've seen it a thousand times, but you still point it out every game.
Well, that's terrific. Well, we're glad that you're well represented on the pod today. So we typically start with lineups, and I normally ask Tim his thoughts, but you being our guest, I'll ask you, what did you think of the lineup today, particularly with Winks and Højbjerg as the midfield pairing?
Yeah, I mean, I wasn't surprised because obviously, you know, Ndombele played against Fulham, so I was like, oh, okay, but I wasn't too happy about it. I mean, I'm not the biggest Winks fan, which is quite sad because I know he supports the club and like he tries really hard, but I just don't think he's got the quality. So I was a bit like, okay, Palace have not been great recently. So, yeah, Zaha's been out and he's on the bench. So I was like, oh, you know, he might be able to deal with it. So I was happy to see Højbjerg on always because he's just transformed. But Winks in particular, wasn't too happy. Doherty wasn't happy. I'm not a biggest fan of him. I think he's not done much to prove that he should be playing over Aurier. For me, I prefer Aurier hands down, but I can understand they need rotation, but I just think he's not good enough. But he got an assist.
Okay. Clearly you've been coached. Vash coached you, didn't you?
No, I haven't said a word. I'm thinking she could just take my slot full time on this podcast because she's saying everything that I would have absolutely said. So yeah, it's
hardly wasted a minute before trashing Doherty.
I think she took too long, I think, man.
And I'm like, how are you getting assists? Like, how are you always getting assists? Because it just means he's going to keep playing. And I'm like, you don't do anything. Like, you shouldn't be playing. But yeah,
I don't want to speak for Tim, but I bet that was like the one glaring, you know, thing that he noticed. What'd you think, Elena, of Winks' performance today? Because I think most people probably felt the same as well. Wanted to see Tanguy, right?
Yeah, I mean, I was. He did all right. He did well, to be fair. He wasn't the best, but he did his job. I think that they didn't create too much. I mean, we hardly saw Lloris. Lloris didn't touch the ball, but they didn't get too far back, so he didn't have to track back. He just got to tidy up, you know, pass to Højbjerg, Højbjerg pass to him, go forward. One thing I like about Højbjerg is that he has a CM mind. So when he does win the ball, he goes forward. He's not just a DM. And I feel like that is so, like, so important for a DM to be like that. So it made Winks' job easier that they didn't actually press him too much. Because I know Winks under pressure, we all know what happened in the West Ham game, eh? Winks under pressure, he doesn't clear. He just, you know, gives it away. So, yeah, a bit worrying.
So, Tim, you saw him in the lineup. What was your fear? And what'd you think at the end of his performance?
With Winks, I think the issue is just the pairing in general. When you put both him and Højbjerg next to each other, you don't have much of that directness. You don't have the creativity. And when you're facing a team like Palace, with what we saw in the first half in particular, is they're sitting back deep. So you need someone with some creativity to break them down rather than just move the ball side to side. So if it would have been Winks and Ndombele, I think we'd be talking a little different about Winks' performance. But when you put both of them together, going up against a team sitting deep, that's where the problem came in.
Yep. Well, look, I mean, I think the one thing that we did see today, right, was we saw the front three that we were all hopeful that we'd see in the lineup. So Dan, kind of, you know, walk us through your thoughts today on the on our front four.
For very good players that are working in their position. I think, I know Lucas, I've slammed him plenty of times on this show, but I like where he's playing now. I like him in the number 10 because he's awful off the ball. He's awful making runs. He can't get onto the end of passes. But what he is good at is he's good at getting the ball and beating a man. So put him in the middle where he can't get in anyone else's way. He can just sort of leave Son on the left, leave Bale on the right. It works. And if it wasn't for Bale's resurgence in the last few weeks, we'd be talking more about Lucas because he scored a couple of goals, especially against West Ham, a couple of really nice ones in the Europa League as well, and made the first one today, which at the time, you couldn't really see a goal coming. We were dominant, but we weren't breaking them down very easily. And if it wasn't for him pressing really, really well, which he did most of the game, actually, we wouldn't have got that first goal and the game could have been different.
And hey, controversial point number one right here. Keep an eye on Vass's face. I think Lucas works better in that spot right now with what we're seeing than Dele would. I do, because I think he's very interchangeable with all three players around him, Kane, Son, and Bale. And so with that, I believe that, like, Elena doesn't agree with me, but with that, I believe that it creates a lot of confusion with defenses because I agree that Dele is a more skillful player. But with the way that I guess that those four are playing together, Lucas has been really well these last couple of games. You can't deny that. Lucas has been playing really well. And I just think he works well with those three around him.
If you go back and listen to last week's pod, I said exactly the same thing. Yeah. He plays better in that slightly deep, not deep, in that sort of number 10 that's a bit deeper, allowing the front three to get on the ball and make their runs. And as Timmy quite rightly said, it allows Lucas to pick up the ball and run at people without really getting in other players way too much. So I've been a big critic, like Dan, of Lucas. He hasn't really been delivering or doing very much and been very, very frustrating over the last season and a half, possibly more. But yes, since putting him in the side in this particular role, it does seem to suit him and it works well with the other three. So as to whether he's going to be better there than Dele, I'd like to see more of Dele in that role to come to a decision on that, a definitive decision on that. But right now, yes, he's playing very well.
Yeah, I don't think there's any argument that recently it certainly has worked. That first goal doesn't come without Lucas being as aggressive as he was and pressing like he did. Thoughts on that goal, Elena? What got you riled up? What was nice for you to see there?
I mean, the way Lucas got the ball back was just it was like he kind of could see it was going to be a goal. I think where the positioning was, the whole attack was sort of positioned in places where a lot of the time that's not what it's like when we're attacking. We've got one or two players up top and it's like you don't have many options. We had all our attacking threats up there. It was like knock it in, just get it in the back of the net. And obviously Bale getting the goal was it was great. It's then tapping in the end, but it was great.
There's something weird, right? Sorry. There's something weird. I noticed this week, right? And I'm going to be unashamedly say that I think as great as Harry Kane is, Harry Kane's the best player I've ever seen at Tottenham. But I think my favourite player who I've ever seen is Gareth Bale. I think, I don't know why. Maybe I was a bit younger at the time when he was doing all this stuff. Yeah, absolutely. So when he scores, it kind of means like 5% more for me than any other. It's so weird. I noticed it this week. When he scores, I'm slightly more happy than I am usually. Yeah. It's really bizarre.
Yeah. I don't know what it is about him, right? Oh. I mean, he's got like, if there's ever been a player that like has been closest to like, you know, Cristiano Ronaldo, like sort of aura, a guy that can do just incredibly special things. His style of play is sort of unlike others. And, you know, we hadn't really seen that from him until the past couple of 3 weeks. And not only are we starting to see it consistently. I mean, not just, you know, turning up at the right time in the right place. He's just running past people, making incredible passes, doing really, really great bits of skill. Go on, Elena.
Why did Kane take our free kick? Kane, we understand you really want to take the free kicks. Like, we get it. But, like, bro, you need to, like, realise, no, you can't do everything. And free kicks are not your game, so just let Bale take them. I mean, when I see Bale breathing and he's got his arms out, like, and he's breathing and he's ready to take a free kick, I just have nostalgia. For me, it's like, oh, it's like 2013 again. So, like, I just wanted Bale to take it. But, yeah, Kane just needs to come off free kicks and just do everything else you do. But just so you know, you're not the best.
You know what? I mean, just you know, let's have a quick discussion just about free kicks alone. I mean, what that really speaks to, we started talking about this a couple of weeks ago when we started to see this resurgence of Bale. I mean, Gareth Bale doing things that we've known him to do. But, you know, you think about the two of those guys sitting over a free kick, it just speaks to the fact that now the load can be carried, right? And you know, so we're not so reliant on Kane and Son. And now there's four or five and you know, throw Tanguy in there as well, maybe another player that can really threaten you on and you know, as Vass pointed out and Tim has pointed out, Lucas in the middle is doing that as well. So Tim, I mean, we laughed about it before we came on, right? But literally since you turned on Jose, we haven't stopped losing, with maybe the exception of like the Brighton match, but certainly, right? I don't know, maybe he listens to the pod, but it seems like he gets a good grade from us over the past 3 or 4 weeks, right? How can he not?
Yeah, I mean, how can he not from what you've seen? I don't know what Spurs supporter is not happy with the form we're in right now. And shout out Charles Zollers. He tweeted us and he said, "Isn't Jose we trust back in motion? Seriously, though, he has done almost everything you guys talked about, whether it be sticking with the same center backs and including Bale and Dele. Surely he gets credit from you guys." And yes, he does. I think the biggest thing was just no stability at the back, the constant changing, that center back carousel. And now we have, what is this, four games in a row, I believe now, that he's stuck with Sanchez and Toby. And we've seen the fruits that have been born of that center back pairing. Yes, we could certainly upgrade at center back, but they're getting comfortable playing with each other. And Sanchez has been really good when he doesn't have to worry about being a leader. You stick that, you know, leadership presence with Toby next to him, and Sanchez is able just to play his game and focus on that. And it's been working. So, I mean, yeah, credit to Jose. I can't say anything bad about what he's doing right now.
Well, look, I'm going to bounce around a little bit, right? Because we, for all intents and purposes, we dominated the first 44 minutes of that first half. But then we give up a goal. And I don't know, I'm looking at the four of you, and I'm like, who am I going to ask this question to? Like, how you were feeling in the 46th minute. All right, Vassal, I'll start with you because your cheery face.
Because you know what's coming right here. And that is, how did we concede that goal? I mean, to be perfectly honest, just to wind it back a little bit, up until Lucas did that great work and we scored that first goal, we were making it too easy for Palace. We were just moving the ball too slowly. And then we got the goal, and then for about the last 10 minutes of that first half, we just kind of eased off and somehow gave Palace the initiative. But the goal was just sloppy that we conceded. Lucas tries a run through midfield, something that we were just crediting him for a little while ago. Falls over himself, gives the ball up when he could have really passed and put us on a good attack. They break down the other end. Doherty's half asleep, like usual. Doesn't cut out the cross. Well, first he gets caught in no man's land. Then he's recovering. And then he just sort of meanders out there while the guy just gets ready to cross the ball. And then before you know it, it's in the middle of the area. And I don't know what Toby was doing, to be perfectly fair. He was on the wrong side of Benteke. And there you go, 1-1. Doesn't take long to concede, does it?
That's very reminiscent of Jose blaming Deli's flick for that goal against Stoke. It all starts with Lucas. It's all because of Lucas.
Everything starts with Lucas, man.
I want to give Dan a chance because Dan in the chat said, well, you know, fair's fair. That was a pretty good goal. So, Dan, I mean, what do you mean when you said that?
So, I said, I think that people overreact a bit to individual errors, when sometimes I don't think the individual error was the reason why we conceded the goal. Yes, Sanchez could have dropped back. Yes, Toby probably could have challenged better. Yes, Doherty probably maybe could have closed down a bit better. But I think the reason why we conceded that goal is because we gave up possession and we couldn't keep the ball for the last 10 minutes and we invited them onto us. I think that was a bigger reason why than ever. And look, let's be honest, it was a lovely ball in and it was a really good header. And it was a nice move as well. So especially when we win, I'm going to not say anything too negative about it.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
So we go into the half, and I mean, mixed feelings. Obviously, we for the most part, we were without question the better team. Another letdown before the half. Elena, what were you thinking that we would do when we came out for the second half?
I mean, this is going to be a very, very pretty controversial, but I'm still going to say it anyway, aren't I? For me. Funnily enough, I actually thought we'd be better in the second half because we had conceded. Because if we go into half time at 1-0 and we come out, we try to defend that 1-0, and then we concede in the 70th minute. For me, that's not good enough. And that was my problem with the Fulham game. I got absolutely slandered just because I said we got lucky. And to me, that is what happened in the Fulham game. So when we came out in the second half, I was like, we might actually attack because we have to. And if we attack, we have the attackers. We have the right players that will get up there, get in that space and actually get a goal. So coming out the second half, I was like, do you know what? We actually might be better off 1-1 than 1-0. I always feel like we either have to be 2-0 or 1-1 at half time, because I don't trust Jose with a 1-0 lead, then I don't trust our defence with a 1-0 lead. So funnily enough, I was like, you know what, we're actually going to have to come out now and actually going to have to come out and attack them. And it shows when we do play to our strengths and we are under a bit of pressure, we can kill games off because we have the right attackers. So I was pretty, I wasn't too worried, to be fair. So funnily enough, I was like, you know what, this is good for us, because we won't stop attacking now because we have to go at them. And obviously when we did it once and then, you know, the tactics didn't change, we just kept doing it and then we ended up winning 4-1. So I was pretty okay. Funnily enough.
You nailed it. Elena must have been about the only one, because I think they'd got the 1-1 at half time, and then you see Zaha come on. Well, we certainly on social media, you see the kind of negative comments from a lot of Spurs fans. Oh, we know what's going to happen now, and Zaha's on. He's going to. I really did think Zaha was going to come on and start roasting Doherty, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
Thankfully, that didn't work out that way. Sorry, go on, Sam.
Well, let's stop and talk about this, because, you know, we talked about the importance of winning, you know, three in a row and what that would do to confidence. But let's just stop for a second and not just talk about the win today, but the fact that we had a letdown before the half, where we've had before in the past, yet we overcame that. So, Dan, I'll ask you, how important, and do you think we get any additional confidence from not just winning today, but from winning from the position that we found ourselves in to start the second half?
Maybe I'm not totally convinced, but I mean, Jose will play it as a positive. It'll be like, look what happened. You got dragged back, and then you sort of turned around and you made it 3-1 and 4-1 in the end. So, yeah, to be honest, I was actually talking about what Elena said. Everything she says makes total sense to me, and I completely get it. But I think at the time I was a little bit worried. I just sort of thought, you know, we've had our moment. Are we going to struggle again second half, a bit like we did against Fulham? But you're right. We have got the players to score lots of goals. And playing to our strengths, like she says, is absolutely perfect, because I'm sort of moving this on, sorry. But we've got a lot of attacking players that are playing actually quite well at the moment. Kane's playing well. Bale's playing very well. Son, not so much. I don't think this style suits him as much as it did before. But even Lamella when he came on, Lucas, Dele when he played the other day. We've got a lot of attacking players that now we're playing to their strengths, can score goals and can look good. So, yeah. Don't know what you guys think.
Well, Timmy?
No. Tim, you think our mentality grew a little bit today?
Yeah, I mean, I actually was nervous going into that second half, because I'm thinking, okay, you give up a goal right before halftime, the morale is going to be down. And so I was really impressed by that quick early reaction to come right back and score two goals within, what was it, the first 10 minutes of that second half? Yeah, we had, no, even less than that, first 7 minutes, and we got two back. So I'm really impressed by the mentality of the squad and how they reacted to that, coming out after going down, or not going down, but conceding right before the final, or right before the halftime whistle.
Well, we had a Galazzo early, didn't we?
And, oh, we did.
And Dan said Galazzo in the chat, and I didn't know. I should have put one and one together. Know that obviously Spanish commentators must have screamed Galazzo.
I put this on Twitter. But the worst thing about watching Spurs with Spanish commentary is that I can't understand everything. I can pick out bits, but I can't understand everything. And they don't fucking shut up, honestly. You think you think Alan Smith's bad. These Spanish commentators, just constant talking. If there's silence, they're fucking pissed off. But then when Kane scored, it was a proper old Brazil 94 fucking Golazo. Reminded me of the... Yeah. No, it reminded me of the old Channel 4 fucking intro. Do you remember that, Fess?
Yeah, the Italian football one.
Classic.
But all that goals, though, sorry, mate. The second one wasn't bad, you know. With the it was the cross to Kane,
and the header, headed
it across, and then Bale came in and headed it. That I thought that was a good goal, but obviously,
we've had a load of them.
Kane's took the biscuit, didn't it? Really,
we've had since Bale has started to do, you know, his thing again, we've had a number of great goals. But we had that Galazzo today, but we had something else really special, didn't we, Tim?
Now, oh, man, that's his favorite player, fire assist by Doherty.
What an assist. And so guide us through the assist, and where does that rank in all-time blinder assists in Spurs' recent history?
I mean, I think you got to go number one is Tommy Carroll to Bale. That fire, that assist was so fire. That's what I was saying. This one isn't as good as Vertonghen the Sun against Burnley last season. I mean, that assist in our own box was just key. But it's up there. It's definitely up there. It's those top three fire assists, I would say.
Do you think that could be the catalyst that Doherty needs to just have the most amazing end to his season, picking up confidence from that amazing piece of skill today?
Did he mean it?
I think so. You just need a world-class player next to you just to lay it off to him. And with that, it's just giving him all the confidence in the world. I mean, I don't know why we should even give RA a chance again, right?
Right. You know what? At the start of each game, I think Gareth Bale and Matt Doherty, they have a friendship, clearly, because they're always talking to each other before the game. And I'm sort of wondering what they're talking about. You'd think it would be like something tactical, like Bale would be saying to Doherty, you know, when you come down that right hand side, you know, just pass the ball into me in this channel or whatever, something like that. But then I can't help thinking to myself, is Bale just turning around saying to Doherty something like, what's the odds on you playing fucking shit again today?
I'm thinking Bale's turning the dog to you and saying, hey, Jordan Spieth got a chance to win it today.
Oh, mate, don't talk.
Bale's talking about golf all the time.
Hey, but you guys are talking about body language, and I tell you what, man, the one piece of body language that I picked up today, well, I guess I've seen it before, but man, Bale and Reggie have a thing. Like, they have a thing. Like, they seem to know how to play with each other and understand strengths, and I don't know. Ellen, am I mad? Do you see the same?
I think they've got a great partnership. I think that there's communication there that you can see that wasn't in our team in other areas of the pitch. Our defence, for example, there wasn't a partnership there, which is why we kept saying you need to play a consistent two, you need to play. Whereas them two, they seem to have great communication on the pitch and off the pitch. Like, they seem to be, and there's an understanding up there, and it's so good to see. You can see it. They know where the pass is going to be. You see that with Kane and Son as well, a lot of the time. They kind of can tell where their passes are going to be and where they're going to land.
Okay, what's that noise?
Yes.
Yeah, somebody,
you're hearing it.
Did you see me jump?
It's my phone vibrating.
Oh, it's your phone vibrating.
It's your phone. Oh, it wasn't me, I swear.
Sam's over there tooting.
I got nervous. Did you hear me? I heard it buzz and I jumped up.
Yeah, sounds right, like, oh so, man, I let out a fart, but I thought I muted myself.
Hey, I had a bit of a, I don't want to say nostalgic moment today, but it was pretty cool to me that, I don't know whether any of you thought about this, but Lamella got, or Bale got substituted for Lamella, right? But when Lamella came on, and it stopped me, because I thought, wow, that's pretty wild, right? Because 7 years ago, right, you know, Bale leaves and Lamella comes in with all that pressure. And now to see them on the same team and see a productive Bale go off and Lamella come in, who I thought was great today. Dan, what do you think about that? Did that give you a little flutter? Did that give you a moment to think when you saw that?
The thing is, looking at Bale with any of the players, especially Kane or Dele, it is like a kind of meeting of eras. Do you know what I mean? It's like Dele Alli seems like the sort of, I don't know, he sort of epitomizes the sort of Pochettino sort of post-AVB era, post-Sherwood era. And Bale sort of signifies the sort of Harry Redknapp AVB era, I guess. And to see them both together, it does sort of feel like it's just two teams coming into one. And it's good. And to be fair, at first, when we thought it was just a bit of a nostalgia trip with Bale, it's not turning into that at all. Towards the end of this season, and if we renew him for next year, it's almost going to feel like he's part of this era too, I hope.
And talking of Lamella, what about that flick over to Son for that last third goal, that fourth goal? It was excellent, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm. It's gorgeous. Yeah,
he's been playing well.
Yeah,
you know what I love seeing Lamella 93rd minute running and sliding people from behind to win the ball.
No,
I love that. That's the thing you get with Lamella, isn't it? Constant. He will press for 90. Even if he's not very good at what he's doing in the game, he will still do it, like, for 90. You get effort. That's one thing I love about him.
Yeah.
If he can stay fit, it's great.
It's funny. It was like they were the last sort of five, maybe even longer minutes. You could see the Spurs players were just content in keeping the ball. But there was like a handful of players that when they got it, they wanted to go forward and maybe get another one, like Lamella and Lucas and Sonny all needing a goal and Reggie. But yeah, generally the ball just kept getting passed around just to kill the clock and whatever. That was quite amusing, I thought.
Hey, Vess, I want to ask you a question because, I mean, you're, of the four of us, you're probably the best historian, right? I think about this team and I think to myself, okay, look, I back four issues. They are what they are. I think Jose has figured out to, you know, to have at least some stable component for some success. It seems to be working. But could we end up trying to be like maybe an Ardiles team where we just try to outscore people? That, okay, fine, we might let two or three in, but we're going to score four or five?
No, not under Jose, I don't think. I think it's a situation where, you know, you adapt to the opponent. Jose always adapts to the opponent. I mean, back in the day when Ardiles was manager, I don't think we had any defenders, to be perfectly honest with you. It was like seven attackers and the goalkeeper and maybe one or two other players in the side. It was just ridiculous. But the days of just outscoring your opponents, I think they're kind of long gone. There's always going to be a pragmatism under Jose. And we saw that today. I mean, with the midfield pairing, Winks and Højbjerg, I know Elena said early doors that she liked the fact that Højbjerg does carry the ball forward. And Winks does as well, but they only do it sparingly. And that's kind of frustrating at times because they're too content to just play it sideways or back to the centre-backs. And sometimes it kills our momentum. And I think that's just some of the pragmatism of a Jose Mourinho side. So, yeah, I don't see us going back to our leaders' days, unfortunately, Sammy.
Fair enough. All right. So, Ellen, I don't know how you felt after the Fulham match. I mean, I personally, anytime we get a win, and Tim and I kind of laugh at this sometimes we just don't give a shit how we win as long as we win. Knowing now that Fulham has beaten Liverpool, do you look at our midweek results a little differently?
I mean, not really. Liverpool have most of their team out. So I don't think we can really compare with a team that literally has pretty much their whole second team out. And with all the issues they've had, it's not very shocking, I don't think, in their position, the situation they're in. Scotty's doing great. I don't discredit what Scotty's doing there, because considering where they were and how much he's brought them up and the football they play, it is on the front foot, and they do go at people. And, you know, I do think he's got them playing well. But for me, I think that it's not really about everyone else, about us. And I think we have such a good attacking. In that first half, we controlled that game. We had good attacking outlets, even though we didn't have enough shots per se. It wasn't like we killed their goalkeeper in the first half, but we were controlled and we had shots. I feel like the second half, we kind of just gave it to them. I feel like if we just came out the same way that we did in the first half, we would have looked a lot more controlled. My problem is going forward with that. I don't want to end up 1-0, like today, for example, if we ended up 1-0 in the first half, where we try and do that again just because it worked against Fulham, because I thought that was luck against Fulham. I'm very happy to get the win, but I can also see the faults in playing that way. And that was my issue with the Fulham game, that, yeah, we won and it's fantastic, but I don't want to do that again. Whereas today I was a lot happier coming out on the front foot and actually going for that win. And like I say, I do think that is because we were drawing at half time. Whereas if we were 1-0, I worry that Jose would have said, all right, do what you did against Fulham and just sit back. And for me, that's not going to see results on a sustainable basis.
And also, can I just say that fucking VAR decision for Fulham was horrendous. Yeah.
It was horrendous. I mean, I was there with my dad, we were standing up by the TV, like it's going to be given. Then we're like, it's not given. And we were just like, oh my goodness. Like, we were laughing, obviously, because it helped us. But
we've been on the receiving end of that as well.
In general.
Oh, yeah. The Lucas Moura. Who was that against when he hit
where he fell? Oh, it was ridiculous. It was the worst. That was really bad, that one.
Yeah. To be honest, though, actually, I'm gonna say that I think Fulham's one was worse than Lucas Moura's, because at least Lucas Moura was in a weird position and it did push the ball out. I mean, this guy just got smashed against him and his arm was down by his side. But someone was saying earlier that, you know, like, oh, as soon as it happens for Tottenham, it gets changed, which is fair enough. But also forgetting that the Eric Dier thing sort of changed the rules as well against Newcastle earlier this year. So the rules shit and it's fucking always going to be shit, but at least they're fucking listening and at least they're changing it. So
yeah. It's got to happen to someone.
Yeah, it has to, yeah.
But that's the only reason why I was a bit like worried about the Fulham game, whereas people thought that meant I was not happy with the win, which isn't true. I just like to look at the long-term thing. And if that was going to be a long-term way of trying to get wins, I don't see it being sustainable. Whereas today was totally different for me. We came out the same way we did in the first half, if not even more threatening to per se, like we were actually taking more shots. So that's what I, maybe it's because it's the Tottenham fan in me, what I've grown up to see, but generally that's what I see being more sustainable, getting results going forward rather than sitting on 1-0s when you've got Sanchez and, you know, possibly Dyer or Toby in the back. You're like, it's not, we can't do that, in my opinion. So I think he's listened and he's moving it more forward. I hope so anyway, because I can't see that every week.
I think you make some outstanding points there. I mean, there was a definite difference in performance, today versus Fulham, and I'm right there with you. Any win is always welcome, but that wasn't the greatest of performances. But let's talk about Scotty Parker, Timmy. Let's talk about Scotty Parker. You know, we talk about Jack Grealish's calves. Scotty Parker is high on our list of people to talk about this weekend. Why, Timmy? Why were you and I all we couldn't stop talking about him today?
There's no manager with more swag than Scotty Parker.
I love him.
Like that coat he was wearing today. Like nobody else can pull off the double coat look.
It was coat over coat. It was part safari. It was part hunting coat. If I would have worn that look, I would look like the Michelin man. He looked great today. He looked like GQ great today.
Yeah, he was. He had the look today, didn't he?
This comes from someone who used to tuck his shirt when playing.
Oh,
and
yeah.
He's like,
yeah.
How do you have so much swag off the pitch when you
and
used to tuck your shirt?
Yeah. Go in circles. That's what he did.
Yeah. He did. So listen to this. So 80 years ago when I played, because Hoddle was my idol, and Hoddle always would wear his socks down, never wore shin guards, always had a shirt untucked, short shorts, mind you. And my dad hated it. My dad hated that I wore like that. And he would tell me, if you look sloppy, you play sloppy. Scotty Parker looked the part today and got a win at Anfield. So kudos to Scotty Parker.
Say, you didn't cry getting a win at Anfield like Hasenhüttl, which I really appreciate.
Right.
I'm so grateful I won here. Like, it's never happened before. No. You celebrate and you move on. That's what I like to see. So, random dig at Hasenhüttl. No reason for it. I just really thought that crying was a bit pathetic. But anyway.
I'm right there with you. Yeah, because you act, you act like you're shocked that you're...
You're giving the way to look.
Totally agree. I'll say one thing about Scotty Parker. When he was playing for Spurs and when I watched him, I used to say that if I have a boy that plays, I want him to play like Scotty Parker. And he managed today the way that he played. And he looked fantastic doing it. All right.
just to extrapolate whilst we're on Scotty Parker and Fulham, I think the job that he's doing at Fulham is outstanding. Mm-hmm. He's got a load of players on loan there. And on Thursday night when we played them, they gave us a hell of a game. And I kind of expected that they would. I remember last week, Sam, you asked me which is going to be the most important game, Burnley or Fulham. I think, no, anyway, you asked me anyway. And I said Fulham would be the most difficult. And it proved to be. And he's doing a really good job there. And watch this space. You never know. He may end up at Spurs again in the future.
I wouldn't mind.
What are you talking about? Jose's here. Jose's here to stay.
Pretend that never
happened. Okay, so we got a question
for him. Flip flops again.
Well, hold on, Sam. Before you move off of Fulham, I want to take it back to one thing on the play. And I'm just going to say, I think we're fortunate anytime we get a result from a Premier League side when you start both Doherty and Davies at fullback, because the style of play that we have with the two of them in there is so different. There's no overlapping runs at all. Yep. There's none at all. And so we miss that attacking threat. We miss that creating the ability for Bale to cut inside like he did against Burnley and score that amazing goal. It's just not there when you have both Doherty and Davies. And you saw today with just one of them out with Reggie when he came in, how different our style of play is when you have somebody bombing down the wings, how much it opens up space for our attacking players. So I think I'm going to say that about why about the play against Fulham and maybe why it lacked a little bit is look who we play that fullback. I hate seeing that pairing at fullback, but I get it with REA. You know, I guess he's still dealing with the calf issue. Reggie's coming back from his injury. You're not going to risk playing him every single game. I get the rotation, but you see those two names on the team sheet and it's like, oh fuck, here we go again.
Well, I just want to say it worked in the first half. Mm-hmm. So the second half is definitely a switch of play. While I agree with you, it's not going to be as attacking. You're not going to get those overlaying runs. You're not going to get as many chances created. But the style of play was very different in the first half to the second half. That's where I get that it's not going to be as good, but it was still better before when we were 1-0 up in the first half to when we came to defend that 1-0. Maybe they can't do it for a full game. Maybe that's the issue, but generally I just didn't like this switching approach. It did look like a general, let's go straight, put everyone behind the ball and just try and defend it. And we don't need to do that, even with them two in the lineup.
Mm-hmm. Well, I want to stay with you on this because, you know, look, the one cross today came from Reggie that was just, I mean, inch perfect, and he's had a number of them. I'm going to ask you this because I asked Dan and I asked him this all the time. Are you worried that Madrid will want to take Reggie back?
I really am. The problem is, it's do you go back? Why wouldn't he go back? In the way I think of it is, okay, yeah, we might win a trophy this season. If we don't get Champions League football as well, I don't see if they don't come in for him. If they come in for him, why you would say no? You know, they win trophies and have Champions League football. It's not like you have to sacrifice one or the other playing for Madrid. And it's his hometown. He loves Madrid. If Zidane is still coach, obviously he might not want to go back. Because I feel like that's the thing that's really been iffy with him being there. But if they do come in for him, I do see him going. And it will be really upsetting because he's our best left back we've had since we had Prime Rose. So it's great. It's great to see him. So I would love for him to say no. I just don't see him say no. And my only hope is the manager. It might actually have a reason, might be a reason why he stays. But, you know, it is scary because we've actually signed this guy, but they can actually come back and take him. And it's scary because it's like we have two good signings this year, Højbjerg and, Bale's alone. But yeah, like Højbjerg and him are two good signings, and he might not even be ours next season or the season after. So I really hope we do get to keep him. But, you know, we'll see. I think it's a lot to do with Madrid and where they are and how they're doing and their manager. If he's going to have consistent game time under him, I feel like that's more rather than I like it at Spurs and I'll stay here.
Luckily, they're broke, so yeah. Hopefully, yeah, that's the best thing about it. They're broke.
Hopefully,
so.
They just can't afford it.
That's what I mean. Yeah, yeah.
Go on, Tim. You unmuted there. I know you want to say something.
I was just going to say Jose bought him a ham.
That's what I'm thinking, man. I mean, right? That ham's like, I mean, that's like you got 500 a ham. Pounds.
It was
that's
really
500
expensive.
Pounds. Yeah,
I mean, hopefully he's, you know, buy him more so he can stay. Just, you know, keep buying him some meat, different meats, you know, maybe a lamb, like buy him something else next week and just hope he stays till the summer.
Well, look, I mean, we should certainly watch the space because, I asked this so repeatedly because it's obvious we play so much better when he's in the lineup. We clearly play differently, as you pointed out. Dan, I'm going to ask you this question from VB at VBeats10. Top four hope-o-meter after the week's results?
I think last week I said that I hadn't checked the table in about 4 months. I didn't realize how far off we were. I made the cardinal sin of having a look just after that win, and we're actually pretty close. I think we're 2 points off Chelsea. Is it Chelsea? Fuck yeah. We're 2 points off someone.
2 points off Chelsea, yeah.
Yeah, so the problem is there's about five teams all fighting for that fourth spot, and Leicester, Man United won today, and Leicester won yesterday, I think. So, look, if you wanted me to put money on it, I'd probably say we wouldn't finish fourth, just because we've had three good results. I've got a bit of optimism, but I still think the last few months have shown me that we're not the best team in the world still, despite, you know, smashing Palace and Burnley. So, yeah, we've definitely got a chance. We're not completely out of it again like we were last week. However, yeah, caution needed, I think.
Yeah.
But Bale is back, fellas.
Bale's back.
And ladies, yes.
Bale's back. Possible.
I mean, listen,
yeah, it's possible. Yeah.
This is the Bale that we all thought we were signing back in September, isn't it? And it's took a while for him to get to this level, and he could just be the inspiration that we need that drives us over the line. I think I said something similar last weekend, actually. So, yeah, you never know. It's all getting congested up in those top spaces. So, I mean, Chelsea play Everton tomorrow. West Ham playing Sam's other team tomorrow. So, yeah. It's a long way to go.
I'm going to move on to the next question before anybody asks me about that. So, but you know what? I think it is worth looking at, and I did take a peek. It's now that time of the season where you start looking at what everybody, you know, as you said, there's a cluster of teams, right, vying for that fourth spot, and it's really worth looking at everybody's respective remaining fixture schedules. And I contend ours doesn't look that bad to me. Am I wrong there, Tim?
No, I think the end of the season we have a good run of games to finish on when it's getting so congested up there at the top. I think that final day of the season, us versus Leicester, that could be like a cup final match. I mean, it really could come down to winner of that match gets top four. I mean, that is a legitimate possibility. But we are pretty fortunate with the games we have and knocked out a lot of our hard games early on. I think if you're talking about, you know, top six teams, all we have is United and Leicester left.
And Arsenal next week. Well, no.
I said top six teams.
Yes, you did. Everton. You pulled me out. Yeah, yeah, yeah. You pulled me out.
Don't we play Everton again?
Yes, we do. Yeah. We have Everton.
You know what? We want to be there ready to pounce when one of these teams are dropping off. So, like, Leicester are dropping off. We're winning now. We want to be ready to pounce. What's annoying is that it's not technically in our hands. We're waiting for everyone. You know, we've got to look at other people's results, which is not where you want to be as a club. But I think the whole top six is so close, other than City, obviously. I think everyone else is pretty close. So you just want to be there ready to pounce when teams start dropping off. And I feel like we are sort of picking up some form. So if we can just be ready for when those four spots become available, every game is so important now. Because, you know, you've got Liverpool losing one game, you've got Chelsea could lose their next game, and then you want Tottenham to be the one that wins their next game, and then you're, what, a point away, 2 points away, game in hand, you know. You just got to be ready. And I feel like that's the problem with always chasing, because you're always relying on other people. But it's possible. It is very possible. We just got to keep this form up.
You just look at the last five games. It's Sheffield, Leeds, Wolves, Villa, and then you have that match against Leicester. So it's a decent run.
And then you've got that Leicester match, which could be mental.
Well, that's what I'm saying. It's a decent run to put you in that position, and that last game really could be the cup final game.
Mm. Aren't we playing Villa twice? Have we still got to play Villa twice?
Yeah, we've got to make it.
That's our game in hand, isn't it, against Villa? Mm-hmm.
Oh, I thought it was Southampton.
And like we said on the pod on a number of occasions, Sam, the teams around us have been dropping points and giving us opportunities. And we've been failing to capitalise, you know, ever since, like, we fell away from being top of the league. So this time it's got to be different. This time we do have to capitalise, and that's the thing.
Seems like it was another season that we were top of the league. Seems mental.
It really does. It's a very, very fair comment. It really does. Seems ages ago. All right, Ellen, this is a really good question. This comes from our friend Andy Toronto. He's at COYS YYZ. He asks, how do we prioritize the Premier League from here? As Europa League matches get tougher, I fear putting all our eggs in the let's win a trophy basket risks costing us top four and a spot for Champions League next season, but at least seven teams chasing second through four. What's your approach here if you get to play manager?
Do you know what? It is actually a really good question, and it's actually quite a tough answer because I don't personally think, I think at the minute we play a decent team in that Europa League, we could be out. We haven't actually got a decent team, as in like a team that can challenge us. Yes, they've been tough games, but they're not realistically we should be winning. And even our next round, we've got pretty good, pretty good round. So it's really hard to say, but I think Jose will actually prioritise Europa because he loves that trophy. But for me, I feel like we are so close to top four. We're in a cup final. get top four, because we need Champions League football. Like, I feel like we need a trophy and Champions League football to keep our best assets this season. I feel like it's one of those, you can't have one or the other. Everyone says, well, you know, Kane's going to win a trophy. I'm like, yes, but he can go to clubs that are winning trophies and in the Champions League. Mm-hmm. I think you need both. So for me, get top four, try, obviously go all out for that cup final. If we get through the Europa, great. But it is a very long competition, and I feel like there's more leniency with that. If you're going for top four, if we're one game away from top four, I would prioritise top four in the cup final. But that may be just because I'm so like worried about the Europa. We haven't had the best of times in it in recent years. I know back in the day we were great in it, but right now we haven't had the best of times in it. And I feel like, you know, we've gone out to teams we shouldn't have. We've never really prioritised it properly. So maybe that's just me being, you know, PTSD from not prioritising it under the Poch and stuff. But I feel like we should go for top four and go all out for that cup final. Then you get both. And, you know, we can try go from there in keeping our best assets in Son and Kane and Reguilon as well, because I feel like they need Champions League football. I genuinely do, as well as a trophy. I'm not saying instead of, just in case anyone, because, you know, right now in the Spurs fan base, you have to pick one or the other. Can you play nice football and win games? No, you have to pick one or the other. Or can you win a trophy or get top four? No, you have to pick one or the other. So, I mean, why don't we do both? And so, I know Europa does that, but I just think it's such a hard competition.
So Tim, I'll ask you this. I mean, how do you rate this squad in terms of having necessary depth to have a sort of multiple, you know, cup silverware pursuit? You think we're in how do you rate the condition that we're in, relatively speaking?
I think it really depends on, you know, assuming you make it to the next round of Europa, who you draw, because our Premier League fixtures that are right after that are probably our two toughest ones. Yeah, or two of our toughest. Yeah, it's Manchester United and Everton. You don't have, you know, games like Southampton next up after. It's going to be difficult. So it's going to be tough to prioritize that. It's going to depend on the draw.
Look, go on, Dan.
I was going to say, if we can just get like a night. Well, we haven't even beaten Zagreb yet, by the way. But say we beat Zagreb, and get a nice draw in the quarters that's not too insane. You can, once it gets to the semi-finals, you can push through because it's right near the end, and then the finals after the end of the season. If we can just get one more nice draw in the quarters, it will definitely help, because it might give them the chance of resting Kane for one of those games, or at least just having a slightly easier match where you're not dragged through the mud for 120 minutes or whatever.
Yeah, at the end of the day, we've got nine Premier League games left.
11.
Eh?
It's 11, isn't
38,
it?
38, sorry. You're 38. I was counting 36. You're absolutely right, Dan. Thank you.
12 last week. Was I that far off?
All right, so 11 Premier League games left, and, you know, maybe another four Europa League games gets you to
semi-final.
So you're at the point now where every single game you can go all out now. There's enough fixtures for you to manage and to achieve all your objectives. I think Jose is going to be prioritizing Europa. Yes, like Eleanor says, we need the Champions League, and we've got to keep an eye on top four. But probably of all the league is not in our hands, as you've said, whereas Europa League is. You go into that, and as long as you're getting a decent draw, then you've got every chance. So, and I think Jose's a bit fortunate when it comes to cup draws, so hopefully that will see us through to the end.
Knock on wood. All right, Tim, before we do match previews, guide us through injury situations, both us and thems.
So with the injuries this week, looking ahead, Arsenal have one player that's a potential injury, Emile Smith-Rowe. He's got a hip issue that he's been dealing with, but he was expected to return this weekend. He didn't, so I'm thinking he's available for our match, and that's really it for them. On our end, we have Lo Celso that he's about maybe a week away from a return. He's been training. He's working back his fitness, so he's a potential player who could be available maybe on the bench for the North London Derby. And then Aurier, which it didn't sound like it was too terribly serious, I would expect him to be available for the North London derby, but that's what you're looking at. We were praying that he's available for the North London derby. We need RA back. Those are your injuries looking at the week ahead.
All right. What do we know about Zagreb, Dan? Do we know anything about Zagreb? You're saying we haven't won that match yet. We know that we haven't won it. What else do you know? I asked you a couple of weeks ago. You said they're a bit shit.
Well, yeah, one of my friends said they're a bit shit, yeah. So just blame me when we lose.
They were in the Champions League, weren't they? Like, not long ago.
They're historically.
I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, they're historically a very big club, but I mean, the Croatian league's not saying a lot, is it? Let's be honest.
I'm just trying to ease the blow, just in case it is like a 2-1 or 2-0 defeat or something.
Well, they're 8 games unbeaten in their domestic league, so.
Yeah, who are they beating?
No idea.
Sheepers.
Teams I've never heard of.
I don't trust us against anyone in this state. Like, there's still 3 games on the trot, and I'm still like, oh, I still don't trust Tottenham.
Scarred.
Oh, yeah, PTSD every time. But literally, second one, I'm like, oh God, why do I do this to myself?
All right, listen. Well, you know, I don't want to take any match for granted, but look, the big one is this weekend. Is Sunday. Man, I don't know. I don't know what to make of it. I they're always tough. They're always tough to get your head around. It's always tough to divide objectivity from emotion. I want to go around the room. Vass, I'll start with you. How are you feeling going into the derby? And what's your level of expectation here?
I always hate these matches. I know Tim was saying in the other podcast we had about how he'd love to play Arsenal like 3 times in a week or whatever. That kind of thing. I don't think my heart could cope, really. So, yeah, I'm always a little bit nervous when it comes to these games. I think that they are definitely going to be up for it because of the fact that they are behind us and they'll want to prove a point. They've been playing pretty well, in fairness, but their defence is still suspect. So I think we've got the attackers in our side who are hitting some form that can exploit those weaknesses in their defence. So as long as we defend well against them, I think we will be okay. But it's not a game that I'm going to be looking forward to, that's for sure.
Timmy?
I mean, I always look forward to it. It's a huge match. I love the rivalry. I'm, you know, fucking scared to death every time going into it.
Right. Yeah. There you go.
You love to have the result. So yeah, I mean, I'm right there with Vass on it gives you a heart attack, but I love it because you're so invested in the outcome of that. It's like for that match, the table doesn't matter. You just want to beat them. And you know, I don't care how you do it. I don't care if Granit Xhaka has another shit own, well, it wasn't an own goal, but passes it off like he did off of Chris Wood. I'll take that.
Glorious assist.
You know, glorious. I'll take that as the win. I'll take any jammy goal. Just, I don't care how you do it. You just win this match.
Just win, yeah. It's definitely a JFW, isn't it? Yeah.
And certainly next Sunday
over here in the UK, it's Mother's Day. I know it's not the same in the States and whatever in other countries.
Oh,
but
my God.
There's going to be a lot of pissed off mums next Sunday.
Birthday. I'm 26 on the 15th. Okay. So don't ruin my birthday, please.
Oh my God. I hope you for your birthday and Francis for Mother's Day have a good Sunday. We can all pile on.
I've got a point about this game. So we were just talking about what are we going to do prioritizing. Arsenal, they must be at the point now where they're prioritizing the Europa League because they 5 points behind us, played an extra game. They can pretty much rule themselves out of top 4, in my opinion. So if they were playing next week, if they were playing Brighton at home or whatever, I reckon he'd have rung the changes, old fucking Lego hair, whatever his name is. And I reckon they'd have played pretty much their second string and then used all of their first team
Lego
players.
Hair?
Yeah, Lego hair.
Where'd you get that from? I've never heard of that.
I called him that ages ago and it seems to have become a thing and I don't know whether I started it or what, but it feels like I did.
Take the credit.
It's very, yeah, I'll take the credit.
It sticks to his head, doesn't it? To be honest. I'm a bit jealous of it, I'll be honest. But anyway, so yeah, he'd have played his full strength team. I reckon he'd probably ring the changes next Sunday. However, I don't know whether he will for Tottenham. But if they don't get a good result, if they don't get a good first result, he's going to have to think about the Europa League game, because Arsenal, it's Europa League or bust. And they're playing Olympiacos, is that right?
Yes. Yeah. Which so we all know what happened to them last time.
Absolutely, yeah, yeah. And we played them a couple of years ago, and they're a decent little side. So
we got 2 down, didn't we?
Absolutely, yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah. So
I think Olympiacos would have had more chance if they'd had then crazy fans in the stadium,
yeah,
but that's
probably, yeah, point, yeah.
Probably, but the idea is that I don't know what Arsenal is going to play next week. I mean, I presume it'll probably be their strongest side, because he's probably not. Yeah, it should be, but I wouldn't put it past him maybe resting a few players, which could work in our favour, but might not. So, yeah, it could be an interesting North London derby.
Dan, I mean, other than JF or Tim, I'll ask you this. Other than JFW, if there's one thing that we have to do in that game in order to maximise our chances for success, what do you think it is?
Attack down the wings.
Well, that was simple.
Yeah. He's a genius. The man's a genius. Hire him now. All right. Well, look, I mean, this is the first time in ages where we got exactly what we asked for. We asked for 3 wins in a row. We didn't really give a shit how we got there. We had a game where we shouldn't have had a result, but we got there. And here we are, on the doorstep of a North London derby. And I don't think we can really ask for more. Momentum should be weighted to us. But, you know, as somebody has pointed out, all bets are off. Doesn't really matter what your form is when you go into this fixture. So hopefully we get the result that we want. I'm glad that there's not going to be any fans in the stands. And I really wonder whether that is going to end up making a difference. You know, the typical momentum swings that you'd see in that match might not be as heavy as they typically are, just by way of not having supporters there. So, I don't know. We'll see. Before we close, do we have any shout-outs? Is there anything that I have failed to discuss with you fine people?
No, just the usual reminder for listeners and viewers to help us along by actually leaving us some reviews on iTunes and wherever you get your podcasts from. Do subscribe to our YouTube channel if you want to see what we look like, and hopefully you'll get some enjoyment out of that. And yeah, reviews, questions, whatever, just keep them coming.
Hey, I got one thing. Sammy,
what you got? What you got?
You didn't say gash.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, bash,
nice. Bash, gash, stash, hash. I don't give a shit what you want to call it. I call it 3 points.
Shag.
Love that. That was great.
I do like shag. I mean,
I like shag.
Yeah.
All right,
it's got to be shag. So top shaggers.
Yeah, that's definitely a good name, especially if it's working. I want to thank our guest, Elena. Thank you very, very much for joining us. I want to make mention of your Twitter handle again. You are at lilywhite_TV. You can also be found on the Terrace. That's another YouTube channel. And when do they record?
We record on like a Tuesday normally, and it gets released by Thursday. Kind of depends on, you know, when our fixture is, because we do a little match preview. And yeah, that's normally released by Thursday. But it's got different guests on, and it's just like this, really. Just a little Tottenham podcast, little Tottenham hour. They needed more Tottenham content, so I'm glad that I was the one that joined and finally gave them a Tottenham podcast. They had all the other top six, but they finally have a Tottenham one now, which is great.
Terrific. Well, we really, really appreciate you coming on. It was great to get to know you. Wish you all the best with your channel and on the Football Terrace as well. North London Derby week, we've got a Europe fixture in between. And hopefully we get 2 more victories. Come on, you Spurs.